On this Sunday night, Iran's president is missing. The frantic search effort after a chopper crash in the mountains. The regime's reaction and its future. Long weekend tragedy on an Ontario lake. The deadly boat crash that's claimed three lives. Charged with guarding VIPs.
Are you proud of what you do? You proud of your work?
Global News is there as an elite RCMP squad faces their final exam.
My behavior on that video is inexcusable.
Diddy breaks his silence. The music mogul's disturbing admission.
Global National with Farah Nasser.
This is video shot by the Iranian Red Crescent Society showing its field crews responding to an emergency in the mountains of northwestern Iran. That's where tonight a frantic rescue effort is underway after a helicopter carrying the leader of the country, President Ebrahim Raisi, went down in severe weather. The Iranian state media and officials being very guarded about the fate of the country's leader, except that millions of people have been told to come out and pray for a positive outcome. Good evening and thank you for joining us. The Iranian president, a hardliner who was touted as a potential successor to the country's supreme leader, was returning from neighboring Azerbaijan when the helicopter carrying him and his foreign minister suffered a hard landing. Ebrahim Raisi was instrumental in the recent crackdown against protesters demanding freedom for women in Iran. Tonight, even with the news of Raisi's fate uncertain, critics of the regime aren't mincing their words. Masih Alinejad, a prominent critic, tweeting, "I think this is the only crash in history where everyone is worried if someone survived." Redmond Shannon reports on the frantic search effort for Iran's head of state.
Search and rescue teams trying to find Iran's president and the country's foreign minister. Their helicopter crashed somewhere in a remote part of northern Iran. President Ebrahim Raisi is seen here inside the helicopter. With him on the right, Foreign Minister Hossein Amir Abdollahian. They had been part of a delegation visiting two dam projects on the border with Azerbaijan and meeting with their Azeri counterparts. According to officials, the men were traveling in a convoy of three helicopters to the city of Tabriz when one aircraft went down in the Iranian province of East Azerbaijan. Iranian state TV initially reported the event as a hard landing, later saying it was a crash due to poor weather. Raisi is second in command in Iran, below Ayatollah Khamenei. The supreme leader said he hopes that God will return the men, but he assured Iranians there will be no disturbances in the country's affairs. Raisi is a former chief justice and attorney general of Iran. He was dubbed the Butcher of Tehran after being implicated in the execution of thousands of political prisoners in 1988. Canada and other countries have classified those events as crimes against humanity. The hardliner cleric was elected in 2021. He presided over the months of protests that followed the death of 22-year-old Mahsa Amini after her arrest for wearing her headscarf improperly. And just last month, Iran launched its first direct missile attacks on Israel.
All the major decisions of state, particularly when it comes to regional policy and foreign policy, are taken by the supreme leader and his advisors, really. But the president has an important role in day-to-day governance.
Raisi's government appears to be unpopular within Iran, although it is always difficult to gauge in a country where opposition voices are so strongly suppressed. His presidential term runs until next year.
And Redmond, if Raisi has died or has been incapacitated, what do we know about what happens next in Iran?
Well, Farah, in that case, an interim leader would be appointed, likely the vice president. An election for a new president would then be held within 50 days. Farah?
Redmond Shannon in London. Thank you, Redmond. 63-year-old Ebrahim Raisi, like all of Iran's leaders, is a hardline cleric and a fierce critic of the West. 1 year after ascending to the presidency, he ordered the enforcement of Iran's hijab law. Within weeks of that ruling, Mahsa Amini, a young Kurdish woman, was dead after being arrested for not properly wearing her head covering. Raisi's hardline stance goes back decades. In the 1980s, as a young prosecutor, he sat on a panel that approved the execution of hundreds of political prisoners in arbitrary trials that lasted just a few minutes. At least 35 people are dead after an apparent Israeli airstrike leveled a house located inside a refugee camp in central Gaza. According to witnesses, the blast happened about 3 in the morning at the refugee camp housing displaced Palestinians in central Gaza. Rescuers are digging into the rubble, searching for those missing. There are signs of widening fractures within Israel's wartime coalition. War Cabinet Minister Benny Gantz threatened to step down if Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu fails to adopt an agreed post-war plan for Gaza. In a televised address on Saturday, Gantz set a June 8th deadline for a blueprint to achieve 6 strategic goals, including bringing hostages home, dismantling Hamas rule, and demilitarizing the Gaza Strip. He also is calling for the establishment of a multinational civilian administration for the Palestinian territory. The ultimatum comes just days after another War Cabinet member threatened to quit over Netanyahu's war strategy.
It's a humanitarian crisis in Gaza. That's why I've called for an immediate ceasefire. An immediate ceasefire to stop the fighting. Bring the hostages home.
As you heard, the U.S. president called out the humanitarian crisis in Gaza today, describing a heartbreaking situation during a commencement speech at Morehouse College in Atlanta. Speaking before the historically black all-male college, Biden was largely uninterrupted by jeers or protests that have shut down other college campuses elsewhere across the U.S. over the administration's support for Israel. There is some tragic news out of Ontario now after a deadly boating incident at a lake near Kingston. Last night, 3 people in their 20s died. 5 others are in hospital. Police are still investigating what happened. Lexy Benedict has more on what we know so far. Lexi.
Farah, Ontario Provincial Police tell us the crash happened just after 9:30 on Saturday evening.
2 boats collided in the Bucks Bay area of Bob's Lake, just north of Kingston. Police say many people were still in the water when first responders arrived on scene, but the total number of people involved is still unknown.
We had police from numerous OPP detachments, Marine units from the OPP, Central Frontenac and South Frontenac Fire and Rescue were there with their boats. We had our emergency response team, canine, Frontenac County paramedics were there.
Officials say the boats involved have been described as an open bow fishing style boat and a speed boat. Police have not yet released any names, but say the dead are a 21-year-old and 22-year-old woman from South Frontenac and Elginburg, and a 23-year-old man from South Frontenac. Those injured are from the ages of 21 to 44 and were taken to hospital with a range of injuries. 1 was airlifted. Some businesses around the lake have taken to social media to express their condolences. This campground posting, "Our hearts are deeply saddened by the tragic boating accident on Bob's Lake last night. Our thoughts are with the families of these young men and women and all those affected by this tragedy."
Ontario Provincial Police are continuing to investigate with the help from their collision reconstructionists, as well as the Office of the Chief Coroner. But at this time, the circumstances leading up to the crash remain unknown as police continue to search for answers. Farah.
Lexi Benedict in Toronto. Thanks, Lexi. A mix of positive and disheartening updates in Western Canada's wildfires. In BC, officials say 10 properties were impacted by the fire near Fort Nelson, with 4 homes lost to the flames. But forecast rain is helping firefighters make some progress. Preparations are underway regarding a re-entry plan for essential services. And in Manitoba, nearly 700 Cranberry Portage residents are returning home today after a forest fire nearby forced them to evacuate. The blaze is now under control, and despite damage to infrastructure, all of the town's properties have survived. We're getting an up-close look tonight at the work that goes on behind the scenes to protect VIPs in Canada. The recent shooting of Slovakia's prime minister has brought the issue of protecting public figures back in the spotlight. Our Mercedes Stevenson was recently given an exclusive look at how the RCMP is working to thwart the threat of political violence.
Assignment, PPO.
They're aiming to be the newest recruits in a specialized unit. These men and women from across Canada are about to take their final exam to graduate as RCMP Protective Policing Officers. After today, they will stand in harm's way as close protection details, charged with guarding the lives of anyone from high-profile prime ministers to visiting foreign dignitaries. Today, it's a fictional VIP, including fictional but hostile waiting media that the officers in training have to try and control.
Everybody can have their shot, but I will ask everybody if they could stay behind.
If he's going there, I'm going there.
I am live at the Museum of Nature.
Take a breather, calm and collected, makes for smart decisions.
Here she comes!
The site now secure, I'm ushered in as the VIP, surrounded by officers on their final test.
If you have a question for Mercedes, please stand up.
Yep, just wanted to say hi. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.
I have a question, too.
Are you proud of what you do? You proud of your work? That little piece you did on companies that send light armored vehicles to Saudi Arabia. Now I lost my job.
Enough. Enough of that crap, you Pacific. Whoa.
Fucking touch me. Just get your fucking hands off me. Here.
You okay?
Yeah, totally. We get that in real life, too. So. Minus the protective detail.
All right, guys. So what was the big difference on that one?
He was closing the distance.
Yeah. Sweet line between, like, his opinion and then his emotion in there. And that now, like, the reaction time becomes really too close.
I would agree with you. I think that, right, as soon as he's starting to creep closer and closer, then, right, the risks are increasing. Mercedes, did you feel through the scenario?
I've seen tons of protective details, and it was very impressive.
That's our Ottawa Bureau Chief, Mercedes Stevenson, reporting. Up next, Diddy faces the music, coming up from denial to admission. The hip-hop mogul speaks out after mounting backlash. The news continues on Global National. In Indonesia, several villages around Mount Ibu have been ordered to evacuate after the active volcano erupted once again yesterday evening. Dramatic new images show the volcano spewing lava and ash 4 kilometers high, with lightning sparking around the crater as well. Now, it's unclear how many people have had to flee, but authorities previously recommended clearing a 7-kilometer radius around Ibu. Indonesia's geological agency already raised the alert level over the volcano to its highest on Thursday after a series of eruptions that began more than a week ago. To the civil unrest in New Caledonia now, French forces have launched a major operation to restore order after violent clashes killed at least 6 people there. New Caledonia is a French territory situated in the South Pacific, off Australia's eastern coastline. The civil unrest has erupted in the territory's capital. French forces are trying to regain control of a road linking Noumea to the main international airport. French military planes have been landing at Canadian airports during the weekend operation. Hadi Petracek reports on the volatile situation.
French forces are removing barricades and debris from the main road linking New Caledonia's airport to the capital. After blockades put up by protesters cut off essential supplies like food and medicine and forced the airport to close. Violence and looting erupted in the French territory in the South Pacific last week. 6 people were killed in the clashes. The French government declared a state of emergency, allowing it to ban gatherings and forbid movement on the island. A nighttime curfew has also been imposed. More police arrived by air Friday, the reinforcements meant to restore order. The French military confirms to Global News this A400M Atlas, seen on the tarmac at Vancouver International Airport, stopped in Canada to refuel this weekend, transporting cargo to New Caledonia. The aircraft, typically used by France's Military Air Transport Command, flight tracking shows a stop on the way at Canadian Forces Base Goose Bay in Labrador.
So now there's sort of the staring match.
The riots came after a constitutional change passed in Paris, allowing French citizens who've lived in New Caledonia for at least a decade to vote in provincial elections, sparking anger among indigenous Kanak people, especially those pushing for independence.
And we're seeing this spill out into a whole bunch of conversations about what's the deal with Kanak autonomy, and again, where's the authority of France to kind of reinstitute and relabel processes from 100 years ago.
There have been calls from both sides for calm. The French government has said the state of emergency would last another 7 days. The unrest has trapped hundreds of tourists on the island. With the airport closed until at least Tuesday, Global Affairs Canada has advised against non-essential travel to the capital. Heidi Petrochek, Global News, Halifax.
To the unrest in the Democratic Republic of the Congo now. The Central African Nations Army says it's foiled a coup against the president, Felix Tshisekedi. The attempted coup began early this morning and reportedly involved armed men disguised as soldiers who attacked the presidential palace and the residence of one of the president's closest political allies. According to Congo's army, the perpetrators, including foreign nationals, have been arrested. Three people were killed during the shootouts in the capital. The president was only re-elected in December, and there are reports the coup's connected to Congo's self-exiled opposition leader, who soon after the attack posted on Facebook threatening the president. Ahead, curbing teen vaping. Why some say a federal tax on e-cigarettes won't be enough to stub it out. Former rap star Sean Diddy Combs has released a video apologizing for beating his former girlfriend in a Los Angeles hotel in 2016.
My behavior on that video is inexcusable. I take full responsibility for my actions in that video. I'm disgusted.
The assault, Diddy previously denied, was captured on security camera. These are still frames from the exclusive video obtained by CNN. It shows Diddy throw singer Cassandra Ventura to the floor, kicking her repeatedly and dragging her. Ventura, who performs under the name Cassie, sued Combs last year, accusing him of physical and sexual abuse. They settled out of court. In today's apology video, Combs says that after the attack, he underwent therapy and rehab. Vaping is set to get more expensive this summer thanks to a federal tax increase announced in this year's federal budget. Ottawa says making vaping more expensive means fewer will take up the habit, which health experts warn can result in the same kind of problems plaguing cigarette smokers. But as David Aiken reports, the tax hike may not be steep enough to prevent future generations from getting hooked.
Lovely mango and pineapple.
Marion Burt was an avid smoker until 10 years ago. Then she ordered flavored vapes online and never looked back.
When it arrived, I opened the apple first, and I knew from my first puff that I would never smoke again.
But even she admits she is not the vape industry's target audience.
They should have presented vaping with people like me, with no teeth and a lot of wrinkles, and you bet the kids would lose interest pretty quickly.
But the kids are not losing interest. In fact, one in 15 teenagers aged 15 to 19 vaped every day in 2022, with young adults even higher at one in 10 vaping every day. The federal government thinks it can reduce vaping use among young people by making it more expensive. Right now, vapes can be purchased for as low as $5. A pack of cigarettes costs $14 to $19. But on July 1st, the price of a vape pod will go up between 12 to 24 cents, depending on where you live. Public health experts say that's too little, too late.
That's really close to inflation over the last few years, so it's not really much of an increase at all.
I think the federal government could go even stronger. They missed the boat 10 years ago when vaping started to be introduced.
But some researchers fear hiking vape costs could push some to get their nicotine fix from smoking cigarettes.
We noticed that the use of conventional cigarettes go up after states adopting electronic cigarette taxes.
The federal government did raise cigarette taxes by $3.72 per pack in the budget.
We do need to increase e-cigarette taxes. We do need to increase tobacco taxes. We can do both.
Helping some, but hooking others. A persistent public health problem with no immediate solutions. David Aiken, Global News, Ottawa.
Next, making waves, meet some of Canada's best swimmers punching their tickets to Paris. And the Canadian Olympic swimming trials wrapped up today. It's where Canada's best swimmers have been competing for a chance to represent our country in Paris this summer, including 17-year-old swimming phenom Summer McIntosh. She's one of Canada's best hopes at finishing on the podium. McIntosh set a new world record in the 400-meter individual medley and thanked the crowd for playing their part.
It was awesome. The crowd was absolutely electric. I heard all you guys during the 100 breaststroke, and it really kept me going, so thank you.
Meanwhile, 28-year-old Kylie Massey punched her ticket to Paris in the 100 and 200-meter backstroke. This will mark her third Olympic appearance. She's won a bronze and two silver medals in previous Olympics.
The swimming world is always progressing, and I want to be fighting at the top, so just continuing to work on every little detail that I can find improvement in.
Penny Oleksiak will also swim in Paris, less than a year after undergoing knee surgery. Canada's all-time Olympic medal leader will compete in the women's 4x100-meter freestyle relay.
I'm excited. I think we have a really good team heading into Paris, so I'm just happy to be a part of it now.
And on the men's side, Finley Knox set a national record in the 200-meter individual medley, while Joshua Liendo broke his own Canadian record in the 100-meter butterfly. Both are set to compete in their second Olympic Games. Can't wait to see them all shine at the Olympics. Go Team Canada. And that's Global National for this Sunday night. I'm Farah Nasser, and on behalf of our whole crew here, I want to thank you so much for spending part of your Sunday evening with us. Tonight's Your Canada is the annual Distinguished Gentleman's Ride. Thousands of bikers across the country suited up today to ride around in classic and vintage motorcycles. Their purpose? Raising awareness for prostate cancer research and important men's mental health programs. Until tomorrow, take good care of yourselves and take care of each other. Have a good night.